بسم الله الحمد لله السلام عليكم. What did I say? I said that greeting of peace. Peace be unto you. This is a greeting of all the messengers. And if you've been tuning in, you've learned that this is a greeting of Jesus, Moses, and the last and final messenger sent to mankind, the Prophet Muhammad. Peace be upon him all. We're here every Wednesday, midnights, Thursdays, 2 p.m. If you're in Chicago, CAN TV 36, or at thedeanshow.com, you can see all of our shows there for free. We have in the studio someone who used to be kicking it with the hip-hop celebrities and was one himself. He was living that fast life in the fast lanes. And when we come back, we're going to hear why he put a brake on it. And he did something more fulfilling than all of this combined. When we come back here on The Dean Show, you don't want to go nowhere. We'll be back with Napoleon here on The Dean Show.
Allah, there's only one God, and Muhammad is his messenger. Allah, la ilaha illallah. Allah, there's only one God, and Jesus was his messenger. Allah, la ilaha illallah.
I don't know why I did that. Maybe it's just to break the ice.
When I was 3 years old, my parents got killed by my so-called godfather.
Former member of the Tupac Outlaws.
But I ain't think it was gonna be a matter of life and death.
They murdered Tupac, they assassinated Tupac in Las Vegas. Now that he's gone, I started thinking.
I'm a Muslim now, alhamdulillah.
This is Napoleon.
That's just the way it is.
It's just the way be.
Things will never be the same.
Will never be the same.
That's just
I believe that you can't just live a life and just drop dead and that's over.
Hear me. Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. How's everything?
Alhamdulillah. Thank you very much for being with us here.
The pleasure is mine, man. It's been a long time coming.
Yeah.
We was working on it for a while, but glad to be here.
The creator made it happen. You're here. I'm here.
Definitely.
And hopefully our audience now, they got Definitely. Their ears tuned to the screen, and we're going to try to share your story.
I'm ready.
This is a unique story because you used to be kicking it with a famous rapper, Tupac Shakur.
Mm-hmm.
I got to get mine. You got to get yours.
Yeah.
you were getting yours, huh?
How about that, man? Yeah, definitely, man. Definitely.
Yeah. So tell us, talk to us now. Tell us a little about this life you were living before we get into the details of how you came to Islam.
Basically, I used to be one of the members of the Outlaws, a group that was put together by Tupac Shakur. I went by the name Napoleon. We was more like a family, you know, some of the members, most of the members of the Outlaws was related to Tupac, cousins, brothers, etc. My role, I came in with the Outlaws through Gaddafi, who was the half-brother of Tupac. And it basically was like a family affair that we rode together, did records together, toured together, but that lifestyle came to an end. And for me, growing up in that lifestyle, rolling with Tupac, I never thought that it would come to an end the way it did, you know?
Because he's dead.
He's dead.
How old was he?
Pac was 25 years old when he passed away. He was very young.
That's very young.
Very young, very young. So it was a life, it happened, I didn't expect it to happen that way. None of the members of the Outlaws expected. It was one of them things where we was living a fast life. We was going 100 miles per hour, and boom, we got hit by this, you know? 2 months later, Gaddafi, who actually is the member of the Outlaws who introduced me to Tupac, he got murdered accidentally by my little cousin. So not only did we lose Tupac, 2 months later, we lose Gaddafi. A few months later, before that, my grandmother that raised me, she passed away. So it was 1 year where I see nothing but death. And then that same year, I had a brother who committed suicide.
Mm-hmm.
So that's when I started saying, whoa, something must be up. Something else is out there. Let me figure out what I'm going to do with my life. You know?
Did you know those other rappers like Biggie Smalls, who's also dead. Did you ever meet him?
I never met Biggie because at the time we came real close from meeting Biggie in the wrong way. It was a time that he was at a...
They were feuding,
spot.
Right?
Yeah, we was beefing with him. And it was a time he was at a location that us, Tupac and Suge Knight, we ran down on him. And we almost, if it wasn't for security guards, it probably would have been some blood spilling. So, you know, thank God it didn't happen the way we planned it to happen. But I never actually met him personally.
I thought a lot of these things were done like to sell records. But was there really feuds? These were real feuds that were going on behind the scenes?
This is real. You know, Tupac... If people familiar with Pac, he got shot.
Yeah.
He got shot, and he got shot 5 times, twice in the head, 3 times in his body. And he thought, and only Allah knew the truth, he thought that Biggie knew what was happening, and Biggie supposed to have been a friend of his. Why didn't Biggie tell what happened? So Pac was one of them type of guys where he was a real dude. He wasn't the type of guy that just going to rap about it and let it slide. He had enemies that were trying to murder him, so he looked at it like these people are trying to murder him. So he looked at it like either I do something first, or if I sit back, they're going to shoot me again, and the next time I might not be that lucky, you know?
Now, two things can happen usually in a situation like this. You can now, A, humble yourself and say, hold on, man, my life, I got a second chance now. I need to get with it.
Definitely.
Or you start thinking you're invincible.
Definitely.
Is that what happened with him?
I would say with Pac, I really want to know if he thought he was invisible, because one time we had a conversation with him, and he actually said... He said before he got shot, he always felt like it was something with him. In his own words, he said, I felt like I had a little man that was with me protecting me.
Uh-huh.
He said, now that after I got shot, I feel like that little man is not there anymore. I had nothing to protect me. But I think Pac, he come from a family of warriors. You know, he come from his mother, his father. And he just had an attitude where he admitted many a times himself that I never had a record until I became a rap star. He said, I never had this much drama in my life until I put a rap record out. So he basically had his back pushed against the wall. And Tupac, he wasn't no normal type of rapper. He was the type that if his back pushed to the wall, like most men, they're going to do whatever to get away from that wall, you know, and to push their enemies back. And unfortunately, it came back to hunt him. And, you know, it came back to basically take his life at a very young age. And the reason why I said, because I remember at that time, it was as like Tupac wanted to change. He started to search for something different.
I heard you once mention that he said once he attained everything, because before, like, he was singing about death, that he, like, wanted to die. Is that true?
Yes.
But then when he got it, he said, man, I don't want to die.
Exactly. Now, it was many a times we had one-on-one conversations with Pac, and we would basically be in the living room with him, me and the Outlaws. Most of the time, this is our day. If we're not in the studio, we're not out in the club or whatever, we would just sit and talk with Tupac. And Tupac was a very intelligent guy. You know what I mean? He wasn't no dummy. And we would have serious conversations. And there was times that he would say... he would speak about death often. He would say how he don't want to live anymore. And he would say it's because of the way his life, the way he was brought up, the way he was raised. And then when he get into the music industry, he thought that it would be better for him. He'd be more happy. He said, but it was worse. He was depressed and he was catching a lot of lawsuits and cases going in and out of prison. And it got to the point where he said he don't want to live anymore. But I remember it was a time when we went to Death Row Records and Pac sold about 20 million records. He put a record out, All Eyes on Me. And Pac started to say, it was one time we was in his living room, he started to say to me and the Outlaws, he said, do you remember how I used to always speak about death?
Yeah.
He said, but now that I have all this money, he just bought him a nice house on the beach in Malibu. He just bought him a Rolls Royce. He said, but now that I have all this money, I don't want to die anymore. And a few months later, unfortunately, that's when he got murdered in a drive-by shooting. And for me, that was the first time in my life I actually started to think about death. I actually started to say, well, we don't have control over this. This is a guy who when he wanted to live, his life got taken away from him. And it's no mistakes. Even though I had no religion growing up, I knew that it wasn't no mistake. I knew it was his time. But it made me start thinking. You know, it made me start to think about what's going to happen to me when I'm dead.
Now, many people, they feel like, you know what? Death is far away.
Yes.
Pac was 22. But take a minute, because some of the people, many youth who grow up listening to hip hop and music and that, they know who Tupac is.
Of course.
But for some of the uncles, some of the people who, you know, aren't in tune, can you tell them who
Tupac,
this person
basically,
was?
Tupac is a guy, he's the number one rap artist in the world. He sold over 60 million records worldwide.
60 million?
60 million. Myself was on 40 million records with him alone with the Outlaws. This is a guy who was, when it comes to that type of stuff, he was a genius. You know what I mean? When it comes to the music, when it comes to writing, he was ahead of his time when it comes to that type of stuff. And he was a workaholic. Not only was he a successful musician, he was a successful actor. He started coming up in different movies. So he was a young guy who had basically everything that some of the youth would think that life is all about. He had everything you can imagine. He sold the most records, even to this day, he's in the Guinness Book of World Records for selling the most records than any other rapper. Nobody even passed him even to this day. And most of these records he sold after his death. So Pac was, he was a guy that, he had humble beginnings. He come from two Black Panther parents. So he was raised in a type of struggle, in a type of political movement with the Black Panthers being his parents. Even when his mother was 6 months pregnant with Tupac, the FBI put a shotgun to her stomach and basically locked her up. And I think they gave her over 100-some years in prison. Wow. And she couldn't afford a lawyer. She represented herself and she beat the case. Mm-hmm. So Tupac growing up in this environment, one, that's why he had a lot of lyrics against the police, because he was raised in an environment where literally he seen the police chasing his mother and father around the country. So he was raised thinking that the police is his enemy.
Yeah.
So when he got into the music industry, you notice even though he had a lot of positive lyrics, but most of his lyrics was talking about what he was raised upon and what he seen and what he witnessed in his life. So he was, even to this day, the number one selling rap artist. Even everywhere I go, I never see more people, and I would say unfortunately, I never see more people, especially in a Muslim country, looked up by the youth more than Tupac. Even in Saudi Arabia, unfortunately, you see his name spray painted on the wall.
Yeah.
So I talked to the youth about what his life was, and unfortunately, when he passed, he wasn't a Muslim, but they love this guy. You know what I mean? That's something that we can't take away, that the youth love him, and we here to just let the youth know the truth about that lifestyle.
Yeah. Now tell us, now yourself, you are actually, we talked about this person, Tupac Shakur, right?
Yes.
Yourself, so you were right there, right-hand man,
yes.
You were in that little, you were
the click.
You were in the click.
Definitely.
Outlaws.
I was in the click, the Outlaws.
Actually, selling records.
Selling records. I was on records. I sold over 40 million records.
40 million myself. Records.
Tupac used to refer to me as his protege. I was the only member of the Outlaws when he introduced, he would say, this is my protege. This is Napoleon. This is my protege. And I lived with him. I lived in the same house with him. Me and the rest of the Outlaws, we lived with him. We talked with him. I was with him till he died. So I was caught up in that.
So you name it, we know that, look, as ones who have submitted ourselves wholly, our whole selves to the creator of the heavens and the earth,
yes.
As Muslims, that our creator is the most forgiving, he forgives us our sins. So we don't go out there exposing the small details of all the things, but in general, we'll cover some things just so that the youth and anyone out there, even adults, can benefit from these things. So tell us now, you must have did it all. I mean, you
basically,
were...
Basically, yeah. At a very young age, I was 16 years old when I was with Pac. I did it all, you know what I mean? It got to the point where that lifestyle actually was the reason I started to search, besides the death of Tupac, the death of my grandmother. Even when I was 3 years old, the death of my mother and father, they got murdered in front of me. So all my life, I seen death. One of the things that really changed me and made me start to look and search was that lifestyle, because I got to the point when I left New Jersey, when I left the hood, I thought that the ultimate happiness is houses, money, and cars. This is what the rappers...
Houses, money, and cars. Yeah, that's exactly what they keep singing
this is
about.
This is what they portray on the television. So when I said, once I got these type of materialistic things and items, I said, this, now I will be happy. It was a time in my life, man, I was when I was 24 years old, 23 years old, I had three houses, three brand new houses.
Yeah.
Cars, every time a car would come out, I would go purchase this car. But I remember when I used to go to sleep at night by myself, I used to feel very depressed, and I used to tell myself, how come I'm not happy? Yeah. I have money, I have houses, I have cars. It was something that I couldn't live with forever. I was hiding it on the television. My fans wasn't seeing this side of me, but every night I would go to sleep, and this is what I would ask myself, how come I'm not happy?
So anyone, now this is for anybody. You can be a Bon Jovi fan. There's somebody you're emulating, wanting to be that you see on the big screen, but you think this might be that facade that you're looking at, thinking like that they're all like...
Exactly. I would say everyone is, I would say, to be honest, I would truly believe that if you don't know why you created, if you don't know your creator, you cannot be happy. I would truly believe because Allah says he created us to worship him. So I would think that no matter how much money the people have, no matter how many cars, they can walk down the street, smile 24/7, but if they not worshiping their creator properly, deep in their heart, they cannot be happy.
Now, how did you, the family environment that you were in, were they practicing any kind of religion?
My family was mostly Christians. My mother and father, before they got murdered, they both converted to the religion of Islam. But I was raised with my Christian grandparents. But they was the Christians. My grandmother was the only woman in my life that I actually seen go to church every Sunday.
Yeah.
My grandmother was the only one really trying to practice her religion. But it wasn't really it really wasn't nothing there. So growing up, the religion of Christianity in my household was just something they say, but they do whatever they want. You know what I mean? So it really wasn't too much religiosity, whatever you could call it, going on in my house.
Now, what about this idea? Like, I mean, did anybody try to push, say, look, you better accept that this, that Jesus came and died for your sins, or look, you're going to hell? What about this
family,
idea?
My family wasn't like that. But I remember at a young age, they used to make us go to church. It was a time they made us go to church. But my grandmother wasn't the type that, we was some bad kids, man. Yeah. We was real bad. I think she really wanted us to go to church to keep us out of trouble, because me and my brothers and my cousin, we was the worst of the neighborhood. Yeah. So I think it was more, let me try to get these kids into church to get them out of trouble. But it really didn't work. You know what I mean? It really didn't work. I noticed at a very young age that I knew that Christianity is not the proper way to worship Allah. It doesn't teach you the proper way to worship your Creator. So at a very young age, I said, there is no way this would be a religion from God. There is no way that the Creator would send this religion down to us. Something ain't right with this religion. So growing up, I always put the religion of Christianity aside and said, I just believe in God. I would say, I don't have a religion, I just believe in God.
So the cross teachings of Christianity, that Jesus is God, that God committed suicide, he came down, these things that just don't make sense.
It doesn't make sense, man. And growing up, because you read one part of the Bible, say that it would say that worship the Son or Jesus or whatever, then you'll need to read another part of the Bible where, for example, in the book of Matthew, when the disciples asked Jesus, how do you attain eternal life? And Jesus, they said, oh, good master, how do you attain eternal life? And Jesus said, do not call me good master, as there is only one good master, and he's in heaven above. And then he said, the way you attain eternal life is sticking to the commandments.
Yeah.
So it's very confused that one, the commandments say worship the Creator alone, and then you got somebody telling you to worship Jesus. It was a contradiction. So I told myself that this cannot be the religion sent down from God.
So now, okay, you leave this alone, and now you're living the fast life, living the dream, basically.
A dream.
And now, from the outside, looks all good. Not seeing what's in the heart now. You're depressed.
Definitely.
You're having issues. Like, you know what? Many people, and they cover it up. They cover it up thinking that that big house, picket fence, which you had more, three houses,
bigger
picket fences, and, you know, money, full pockets.
No.
And now, you're thinking about death, which many people, you're seeing it.
It's happening around me. And I'm telling myself, wait a minute, I can be next. You know what I mean? So I didn't want to die in the state that I was living. Even though I never really read anything to tell me what's going to happen to me after my death, after life, I definitely didn't want to die in that state I was living. I knew from the natural side of me, the natural feature disposition, that the way I was living wasn't correct.
It was your conscience, huh?
My conscience was telling me you don't want to die in this state.
So that's a good thing that God put, Allah, definitely, the Creator, put in all of us that you don't want to, like, not listen to it. Listen to it.
Definitely. Listen to it. Listen to it.
Yeah. Man. So, okay, what happens now? Now you go from living this dream to you're living another dream right now. This is the real dream. This is the reality.
Yeah, this is the hot.
How did you come to this truth now? What happened?
I came to this. It happened to be one day I was in a recording studio, and I was all messed up. And you know what I mean when I say I was messed up.
Yeah.
And I got to a fight with my little brother. And it happened to be a guy that was in a parking lot, Muslim. He kind of calmed me down, broke the fight up. And he started talking to me, you know what I mean? And he was real calm, and he was like, what happened if, one of the words I remember, he said, some of the words I remember, he asked me, what happened if you wake up sober and notice that you murdered your little brother? And he started talking to me and talking to me. And eventually he told me he was a Muslim, he invited me to the mosque. So the first time I went to the masjid, man, I think I was about 30 or 40 of my boys, because I didn't know what to expect. And I noticed that it was something inside that mosque that I didn't see in the music industry, I didn't see in the street life. And it was brotherhood. I was wondering why all these grown men hugging each other, smiling at each other. And I said, let me just peep and see what they're upon, what they up on, you know? And he gave me the English translation of the Quran. So I took the Quran home. And the first time that I read the Quran, even though it was an English translation, I knew for a fact right there that this cannot be the words of a man. I said, for a fact, this have to be from the Creator of the heavens and earth. Because I was around poets at this time. Tupac, like I mentioned earlier, he's a genius when it comes to writing. And so I knew what men was capable of writing, the level they can get, the extent of them writing their poems, et cetera, their words.
He's in a sense like a hip-hop Shakespeare.
Yeah, exactly. You know what I mean? Exactly. They even teaching Tupac classes in universities all around America. They got courses based on Tupac in different colleges and universities around America. So I knew right there that reading the Quran, that this cannot be from a man. Everything that I was searching for, I was looking for happiness and different type of drugs. And Allah says in the Quran, for example, truly the hearts found tranquility in the remembrance of Allah. And it's nothing like when Muslims, we remember our Lord and we worship Allah, we get a certain feeling that you don't get from drugs, that you don't get from money, that you don't get from none of this stuff in this world, because that type of stuff is temporary happiness. It's something about being a Muslim and practicing your religion. You get some type of tranquility and some peace in the inside. And also about death. At this time of my life, I was wondering why everybody around me is dying. Allah says in the Quran, He said, every soul shall taste death.
Yeah.
So it was just everything I was looking for, it was in the Quran.
So now there was no ambiguity there. There wasn't something where with this other way of life that it was confusing. Was it clear, lucid, where, okay, this is what the purpose of life is. This is what you need to do to be successful. Clearly defined, a straight path.
Definitely. When I read the Quran, no doubt about it, this was from the Creator. I knew for a fact that this is the way I'm supposed to live my life. Now, it wasn't easy. It's not like I read it and overnight I just became a religious person. It was definitely, even to this day, it's hard. Every Muslim, no Muslim is perfect, and no Muslim could actually say they just living life easily and as if they walking on Jannah. We know that Allah will continue to test us. So once we get past one thing, another test might come our way. So it definitely wasn't hard because this lifestyle is the only lifestyle I knew. So when I started to practice the religion of Islam, my friends started to think I was weird. The way that I was being treated, the way my loved ones was treating me, it started changing. So basically, I went from a type of person where I was the life of the party, I was the troublemaker. I went from basically getting all the attention to basically standing over here alone, and everybody basically saying he's a weirdo now. Yeah. Something is up with this guy. You know what I mean? So at the beginning, it was very hard.
It's telling us right here. You said a few Arabic. You said Allah, Muslim, Islam. There's a lot of non-Muslims. They don't know what this means. You got to define these words.
Allah just means in Arabic, it means the God in the Arabic language. Islam means, Islam is the religion that Allah sent down with all the prophets. And He sent this religion through all the prophets to us, mankind.
Yeah.
Islam means submission to the will of God. The other word was what I say?
Muslim.
Muslim means ones who submit to God. One who's a practicing Muslim, who practice the religion of Islam, is called a Muslim.
Now, we're almost out of time. This is very exciting. You're living a corrupt life, scandalous life.
Definitely.
And now people are on the bandwagon, they're with you. Yeah. Now you submit to the Creator alone, not worshiping the sun, the moon, Jesus, Muhammad, but you wanting to worship and do what the Creator of the heavens and earth wants you to do. And now you're getting a hard time. What's going on?
At the beginning, man, they thought I was weird. You know what I mean? They thought I was weird because, like I said, when I was the one that was always going to the clubs, and now they're telling me to come out to the club, I say, no, I can't do that. I'm the one that always bringing the drinks and the drugs. And now I'm saying I can't do that anymore. So at the beginning, they said something not up. Even when I first became Muslim a year later, I went to Hajj, alhamdulillah, Allah, may Allah accept it, man. I went to the pilgrimage. And when I came back, my group, the Outlaws, was on tour. And in the music industry, the way you make most of your money is from touring. So I called them up and I said, I cannot come on tour. I just cannot do it. So they couldn't believe it. You know, that was the first step of saying that this guy's a weirdo. But right now, alhamdulillah, all the Outlaws are Muslim. All of them became Muslim.
All of them came, all of became them Muslim.
Alhamdulillah.
Now, how long did the transition take? You said it wasn't like something that, it's a jihad, it's a struggle.
Definitely.
So how long did it take for you actually to get to
it
where you are?
It took some while. It took some time and I'm still going through that jihad, that inner struggle. I won't say that I defeated it yet because I'm still going through it. I'm still fighting against what I know I'm supposed to be fighting with. I know myself, you know.
Those temptations that come at you,
definitely,
you know.
Definitely, definitely. And I'm thankful that Allah let me know that He let me know that the fight ain't over yet, because I think we're in trouble if we think the fight is over. So it's still a struggle for me, but it took some while, especially Ramadan is one of the things that basically broke me away from doing the intoxicating myself and destroying my body and messing my brain up. It was Ramadan. I remember the second Ramadan that I ever fast. Allah, he, inshallah, I pray that it was a successful Ramadan, but it definitely was a way to get me away from that lifestyle that I was used to, drinking and partying, etc.
Now, tell us, how did the rest of your entourage, how did they end up coming over? All of them, you said, accepted this way of life.
They all accepted Islam. Edie was the first one that accepted Islam. I remember talking to Edie about when I first came back from Hajj, we was in deep conversations a lot about Islam, and he accepted the religion of Islam. And the recently was, I think Young Noble, he accepted Islam about a year ago.
Young Noble?
Young Noble is one of the members of the Outlaws. He accepted about a year ago. Castro accepted about 5-6 months ago.
Yeah.
You know, Hussein, he's a member of the Outlaws who accepted Islam when he was in prison.
Yeah.
So alhamdulillah, they're all Muslim.
Now some people might say, oh, this is a black thing. What do you got to say to that?
we would say for a fact that the religion of Islam is not a religion for black people, Arabs, or white people.
Well, I'm not black, obviously.
You're European, from Bosnia. Yeah. So this is, that'll be right there, proof against them, or some hawk against them. But basically, I thought the same thing. Before I became Muslim, to be honest, the people that murdered my mother and father was from a group of people called the Nation of Islam.
Yeah, which has nothing to do with Islam.
Nothing to do with Islam.
I don't even like calling it the Nation of Islam. I'll say the Nation.
Nation of Kuf. Some people call them the Nation of Kuf.
Yeah.
So what I thought growing up is that these people are Muslim. They killed my mother and father in front of me when I was 3 years old. I would never be a Muslim. This is what I used to say. And it wasn't until I started to read the Quran and read about Islam, I said, wait a minute. The religion of Islam and what the Nation of Islam upon is two different religions. Yeah. You know what I mean? The religion of Islam, for example, we believe that Allah is the creator of the heavens and the earth. He's not a man. He's not a woman. He doesn't have a race. We can't even imagine Allah in our heads.
Yes.
We know that the Prophet Muhammad, he even said in authentic narrations that he was sent with something that no other prophet was sent with, and that he was sent to the whole of humanity.
Yeah.
For example, Jesus was sent only to the children of Israel. David to the children of Israel. But Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was sent to the whole of humanity. And majority of the Muslims in the world are Asians. Indonesia, that's the biggest Muslim country in the world. Arabs, blacks, Bosnians, Europeans, you got Muslims everywhere. So this is the beauty of this religion. When I first went to Mecca and I noticed I seen people from all parts of the world, all parts of way of life, it was amazing. And everybody was treating each other like brothers. You know what I mean?
Dave Chappelle, who else? Scarface, some of these other.
Dave Chappelle, Scarface.
Shaquille O'Neal.
Is a Muslim.
Yeah.
Recently, Raekwon, he came to the Masjid in Los Angeles. Raekwon from the Wu-Tang Clan.
Yeah.
He just accepted Islam. Ghostface Killer from the Wu-Tang Clan. I ran into him at the airport. He accepted Islam. So a lot of them is running to the religion, alhamdulillah.
Yeah, alhamdulillah, all praises to the creator of the heavens and earth who is guiding the people.
But you gotta want
to be guided, isn't it?
Definitely. We should want to search for the truth. And I think, and Allah knows best, that if we sincerely look for the haq, that Allah will guide us to the truth. You know what I mean? It's that the people, we can't sit back and just think that, okay, Allah will come down and speak to us, a'udhu billah, because some people have that mentality that they're not going to do nothing until they get a sign. The sign is that, look, man, look all around us. We see people dying every single day around us. We see what's happening to the people on earth all around the world. This is a sign, you know what I mean? This is a sign that we should take, we should want to know what's going to happen to us when we're dead. None of us know when we're going to die. None of us know when we're going to die. Every single person should at least be curious about what's going to happen to them in the next life. And we should want to be on the true religion in this life. So it's very important that if it's any non-Muslims looking, we would just ask you that you should read about Islam. You know what I mean? It's not going to hurt you if you go pick up the English translation of the Quran, and it's not going to hurt you if you go read the biography of the Prophet Muhammad. And we would tell you, basically, don't judge Islam by us. Because if you look at us and judge Islam, you will run away from it.
Yeah.
No doubt about it. But if you judge the religion of Islam by the Prophet Muhammad, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, then you would know what this religion is about. You know?
A couple more points before we come to an end. What are some of the... Is this something that is just faith, is personal, or is there a lot of evidence also that Islam brings to the table to show to any truth seeker that this can't be from a human being? This is indeed from the Creator that you got to look at.
Definitely. Even if we just analyze the stars, the moon, the mountains, even if you just analyze the clouds, the sky, just look at this. Who created all this? You know what I mean? Who created the sun? Who created the moon? You cannot say it's scientific. You cannot say it's science, because the science, even to this day, no human being can even come close to the sun.
Yeah.
So nobody even know exactly what the sun is truly made of. They just suggest and they just guessing. What about the moon? Who makes the sun go? Who makes the sun rise and sets? All these are signs from Allah. You know what I mean? All this is signs from Allah that we should ask ourselves, who created this? And there's many signs that's even in the Quran that 1400 years ago they mentioned that mankind just discovered in the 20th century.
Tell us now that for the youth, or even for the adults that now are running in the direction that you were at and you actually ran away from, what advice do you have for them? Closing comments and suggestions.
The advice that I have for the youth, for anybody that's going through that lifestyle, wallahi, man, from the bottom of my heart, that lifestyle has nothing good to offer. That lifestyle, man, it will almost be like a person running away from a house that caught on fire. And he's running away from the house, and he's telling you this house is on fire, and you run past him and say, I want to go inside of it, and I want to see for my own self. It's as if that's how silly and stupid it is, almost, that, especially amongst the Muslim youth, unfortunately, that Allah guided most of us from this, in America, converted to Islam. He guided us from a life of kufr and evilness. We tasted the darkness of that life. We know that it has nothing good to offer. So we should ask the Muslim youth, just use your common sense. While the people running away from that, running to the religion of Islam, people are walking away from millions of dollars just to live a simple life of Islam. This should let them know that this is the proof that we are upon the religion of Allah, the creator of the heavens and the earth. And one thing we want to tell the people, that no doubt about it, there is no true happiness, no success without only through the religion of Islam, only in the religion of Islam.
Where can people, if they want to have you come out and you do some traveling and you'd like to share your story, where can they contact you? You have a website? You have
Yes, they can contact me through the website, NapoleonOutlaw.com. That's www.Napoleon, N-A-P-O-L-E-O-N, Outlawed, O-U-T-L-A-W-E-D.com.
Thank you very much, Jazakallah Hamid, the creator of the heavens and earth. Allah reward you for being with us. And thank you for being with us again here on the Deen Show. I hope you got the benefit from this brother's story of living that fast life, to putting a hold on it and doing the right thing. Doing what the creator of the heavens and the earth wants us all to do. And that's to live according to his will. Because he knows best. He created you, created me, and he wants what's best for us. So when you submit to him, you can't go wrong. Because you're doing what the creator wants you to do. And there's nothing less than paradise. So be sincere with yourself. Realize that death can come at any time. Take the first step. Ask the creator of the heavens and the earth to guide you. It'd only be fair if he did, if you asked. And be sincere. And be willing to follow it up with actions. So, inshallah, God willing, we'll be back again next week to bring you another hot topic, another episode. We'll see you again. Assalamu alaikum. Peace be unto you.
Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Allah la ilaha illa huwa al-hayyul qayyum. لا تأخذه سنة ولا نوم له ما في السماوات وما في الأرض من ذا الذي يشفع عنده إلا بإذنه يعلم ما بين أيديهم وما خلفهم ولا يحيطون بشيء من علمه إلا بما شاء وسع كرسيه السماوات والأرض ولا يؤوده حفظهما وهو العلي العظيم.
Come and see what everyone's talking about.
Prove. If you find one contradiction, it can't be from God.
But the rational idea, the rational explanation is, you do your best.
Give up worshiping God is one. I will never give up spreading this message.
I hope that you take that necessary step. You don't know if you're going to live till tomorrow. So you got to find that urgency to do the right thing right now.
The reality of life usually doesn't sink in until tragedy comes.
You get a few bad people, the media grabs a hold of that and spends it the way they want to.
If you say that you do not believe in Jesus, you have stepped outside of Islam. You cannot be a Muslim. It is attended our faith to.
It's cold, it's late, everybody's sleeping. I arise and ask Allah to forgive me. Oh Allah, you see. Oh Allah, you know. All the sins I do, I turn to you to forgive my sins and my heart.
I'm your sinful slave. You're my loving Lord. I'm the one who runs away. Oh Allah, guide me.